start out.
Now I'm so tall.
She's so tall.
I've just added 4 inches to my height.
We're all gonna have to do that.
We have Commissioner Angel Gomez here. He always teases me when I'm making a speech. He won't say it, but he will think, Kamala, stand up, even while I'm standing. So eat your heart out, Commissioner Gomez.
That's right.
On behalf of AAUW Weston, I welcome you all to this wonderful event where we are going to honor some extraordinarily wonderful women and a girl. My name is Kamala Anandam. Don't try to pronounce it. I'm the president of AAUW Weston. International Women's Day was established by the United Nations in 1975 to honor women and girls all over the world for their services to their communities, to their countries, and sometimes internationally. This year's theme that United Nations has selected is the gender agenda gaining momentum. We are not there yet, but we are gaining momentum. And during this program, you will hear how the momentum has gained in the United States. AAUW Weston was established in 2007, and every year we have honored women and women's groups for their voluntary services to their communities. I know Mujeres Latinas was honored at one time, and the Harvest Drive was honored at another year, and we have selected some extraordinary women and a teenager for this year. Recently, AAUW staff, we are a national organization with headquarters in Washington, D.C. We lobby the Congress quite a bit to pass the laws that have a positive impact for women and girls. And just recently, last week, the Violence Against Women Act was passed. And our staff were at the White House as our president signed that act into law. And at that time, he read something about International Women's Day. And I want to read it to you. This is from President. On International Women's Day, we celebrate the many milestones on the road to gender equality and recommit ourselves to fight for the rights and opportunities of women and girls around the world. Empowering women isn't just the right thing to do, it's the smart thing to do. When women succeed, nations are more safe, more secure, and more prosperous. Over the last year, we have seen women and girls inspiring communities and entire countries to stand up for freedom and justice. And I'm proud of my administration's efforts to promote gender equality worldwide. So that was very nice coming from the president himself. You do have, when you came in, you were given a brochure like this one. This tells you all about AAUW. It's a national organization with 1,000 branches all over the country and more than 100,000 members. And there is also inside it, if you might see it, is an application form. I have to plug in for my branch, so you have to give me the minute that I need to say it. If you use this particular form, you are saving some money. Instead of, not only are you saving money, your national dues will go until June of 2014. So you may not have brought your checkbook today, but use it and mail it. All the address and everything else is on the form itself. You also got an information about a luncheon coming up next Saturday at Grand Palms in Pembroke Pines. So if you could join us there, it will be great. We will be talking about equal pay day. Can you imagine in 2013, in this country, we are still arguing about equal pay, which should be automatic. It affects women, 78 cents to a dollar that the man earns for the same job. Black women earn less, 67, and Hispanic women earn 59 cents. This is the national statistics. So we will be talking about equal pay day next Saturday. And this year, we are specially privileged and honored to celebrate this event with Mujeres Latinas, Impulse and Empowerment.
Impulse and
Mujeres Latinas, Hispanic women empowering Hispanic women. So we are very happy that we are doing this jointly. And to you, ladies and gentlemen, I present Maria Antonota Diaz, who is the president of Mujeres Latinas.
Good afternoon. My name is Maria Antonieta Diaz. I am the president of Mujeres Latinas. For us, it's a very, very proud afternoon to have to be here with American Association of University Women doing this great event, and also honoring the wonderful women. I just want to tell you about Mujeres Latinas. Latin Women Empowering Latin Women was founded as a result of the development of a college essay about the need of the Hispanic community in USA, which Tammy Cohen Furman and Regina Rabachi, both from Colombia and residents of Broward County, had to deliver in one of their classes. Proud of the results and planning to make the... Let me put this... proud of the results and planning to make the idea a reality, they invited other Hispanic ladies to discuss it and found the support and willingness to do it. And that is how the organization was founded in 1999. The very first meeting took place in different parks in the city of Weston. Until the month of November of the first years of existence, Ileana Arias, attorney at law, was requested to issue the necessary requirements to incorporate the organization in Florida. Mrs. Arias, a native of Venezuela, is still our legal representative. So this is how Mujeres Latinas is registered to legally operate in Florida. Mapi Salcedo, a native from Venezuela also, was elected the first president, who formed her board of directors together with Maria de Los Angeles Villar, Ingrid Trofen, and me, Maria Antonieta Diaz, Sandra del Valle, Maria Antonieta Peña Herrera, Zoraida del Campo, Laura Cabrera, Ileana Arias, and the two founders who led the organization until the following election in December 2000. Our organization have various departments in the areas of art and culture, education, business, health and family, and public relations. Also, I want to present you our mission. Our mission is informing and guiding the Latin women and her family in the process of integration into the American social and economic system, while preserving her roots. Okay. Our programs and activities. We have many programs throughout the year. Every 2 weeks we have a breakfast here in this same venue that we are And also we are starting a breakfast every 2 weeks in Doral next March 26th. Also, we have a celebration on Mother's Day every year, a beautiful celebration, and our annual gala that is our main fundraising event. And every 2 months, we have a business networking meetings. In addition, we have many programs for a small business and also for individual growth. We think that the women and their family to come here to US needs support. The last 2 months, we are developing a beautiful program with American Association of University Women and the School Board of Broward for mentoring for girls in middle school. That's a beautiful thing that we are doing right now. If you want to join as a mentor, please call us, visit us in our website, and you can help these girls to finish their high school successfully. And also we do some things in the health area. We do free mammograms for women, and also we have a health fair every year. Okay, our vision and value, we want to be knowledge in Broward County, and also right now we are developing more space in Miami-Dade County also, to become the most important source for Hispanics, and to become an emotional support for families, and we want to promote the Hispanic culture. Our board of directors is Pamela Serrano for Costco, and Yvonne Salas from Portada Magazine, Isabel Parra from SBA Airlines, Ana Valladares in Education and Arts, Linda Gomez, Community Outreach, and Janet Perales from Vaira in Health, and Sandra Ramon from El Venezolano in External Relations. Some pictures of our events, our annual gala, that's our picture from our last gala. With Latin flavor, of course. Last year we have many very important events. That's one of the most important. We having a coffee with our Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz, talking about health reform. We do a basket brigade for Thanksgiving. More than 100 families have another reason to give thanks on Thanksgiving. And that's some pictures of our bi-weekly breakfast. Our main sponsors are Broward Health Weston, who give us the venue to do the breakfast every 2 weeks, and Costco, who bring us the breakfast and also the meals that we provide today. Our webpage, mujereslatinasbroward.org, and also you can find us on Facebook. On March 26th, we have the first meeting of breakfast on Doral. Millennium Atlantic University is the venue. And we have Alberto Sardinas from Univision Radio. It was a spectacular. El poder de tu historia is the power of your history. And it's a very, very nice conference. Okay. That's it. If you want to be a member of Mujeres Latinas, you only have to pay $30 a year. We have applications here if you are interested. Before you go, we have a token of appreciation for every woman here. We have a beautiful rose for you. Don't leave without your rose, okay? Thank you very much.
My name is Linda Gomez. How are you? Welcome, everyone. And everybody hears me, right?
No.
They
no.
have mouthfuls. No. But they, okay. I'm always, she always tells me what to do. Any event. Welcome to everyone. And I am the past president for Mujeres Latinas, Impulsando Mujeres Latinas. As Kamala says, Hispanic women empowering Hispanic women. And I'm here, I'm supposed to be reading the proclamation, but we have in the audience our Commissioner Angel Gomez, our Commissioner and Vice Mayor. So who better than our Commissioner Angel Gomez to read? Be my son.
Yeah. Thank you, Mom. So Yvonne, you tell my mom what to do. Now she knows how I feel because she tells me always what to do. I was
but you
out
obey
there.
Her. She doesn't
I,
obey
no, she doesn't obey me. I do obey her. I was outside and Maria Antonieta was still in her daughter. Don't forget, say hello to Commissioner Gomez. And she says hello and she looks at me like, really? My mom is telling me to say hello to you. And I said, yeah, don't worry, that doesn't end. My mother, I'm 43, my mom still tells me, make sure you say hello and thank you. And when you go up there and you get in front of everyone, make sure you say hi and thank everyone. I will, Mom. And so he said, where is she? Where's her daughter?
She's pretty
well,
back there.
She's hiding back there. She's beautiful. It does not end, honey. I'm sorry. It's not end. Like my mother said, I'm Angel Gomez. I'm the Vice Mayor of the City of Weston. And there's a reason why I'm here. And I'm here to help celebrate women. And I have a few very, I know many women, and I'm looking out here, and I see one in particular that I know that is in the audience that we definitely have to recognize. Viviana Pirici is here from the Office of Congresswoman Debbie Weston Schultz. Vivian, thank you so much for being here. I know you're here as you, but you also carry the big weight of representing Debbie, who we love so much, and she works really hard for women and men and children and everybody up in Washington, D.C. So we're happy you're here. And but I do have quite a few women in my life that are important, starting obviously for the most important one in my life, that's my mother, Linda Gomez. I look up to her all the time. And she's a guiding person, you know, kind of like that sticker, what would Linda do? That's what I have on my car. What would my mom do? I also have my wife and now my 14-year-old daughter. And it's important because at the end, when you know, behind great success and great safety and great leading moral values that we have, in, you know, as a country and all the way down to a community like ours here in Weston, you have very strong, passionate, strong women that, generally speaking, like to work, you know, behind the scenes to make things happen, and that's the truth. That's the truth. I am. By trade, as an educator, for work, I'm an educator. I'm the vice principal of a high school. And we're talking about two organizations led, one by Kamala and the other one by Maria Antonieta, who work really hard in representing women's rights and representing and celebrating women that are doing the right thing around the world. And one of those things that they do try to work with, and they're working presently, where's Kamala? There's Kamala. That they're working presently is gender equity as it relates to pay. And I have to tell you, you know, if you want to find a place where that disparity is very, very tangible, that you can touch it, you can see it, you can feel it, you don't have to look at a job that men get paid more than women. Look at a job that traditionally has been identified as a job for women. From the beginning of times, being a teacher was a job that was always identified as a job for women. If you're my age or younger, a little bit younger, and maybe a couple of days older, you remember the little house on the prairie and the kids went to school and the teacher came out with a little bell at the top of the hill, and all the kids ran up that hill to go to school, and outside of that door was a teacher wearing an apron and with a bell in hand, and it was a woman. And teachers were always portrayed as women, because it was mostly women. And right now, to this day, although most teachers are women, unfortunately, one of the reasons why the profession of education, which is, I'm a little biased, but I think is one of the most important professions in the world, the one that, you know, we focus on educating the future of our world, the children, that profession is just grossly underpaid, is not paid the way it should be. And people say, well, why do we not value the importance of education? Absolutely we do. We know how important education is. We do. No question about it. But overall, the job has always been one that was traditionally for women. So to strive forward as we try to match other professions that are similar, if not less important than education, and to get in those people who work in education paid at the same rate, we're fighting a long history of starting very low in the paying scale, because again, it's the woman's job. And so that's one thing I wanted to share, just so you know. Come on, you're giving me the hook, is what you're saying. And, Emma, I'm almost done. Emma, I have so much to tell you. We have until 4. Alright? Alright. Alright. Okay. Now, so as a commissioner, I'm here because I do appreciate what the American Association of University Women, together with always, you know, hand in hand with Mujeres Latinas, Impulsando Mujeres Latinas, side by side, these two, and again, you know, these two Western organizations, I know that you guys are way beyond Weston, I know, but I'm very, also very selfish and biased, so it's all about Weston. These two organizations that were born in Weston that are great ambassadors of this city that we're very proud of. And if you don't live in Weston, I'm sorry, I apologize that I'm speaking this way, but then again, I'm very biased, I'm very happy about Weston. That are out, these two organizations are working so hard representing the rights of women and young girls, young ladies, like the one that is here with us tonight, and many others that are not here. And somewhere along the way when they speak, somehow Weston gets related to their name. So we're very lucky as a city that these two organizations actually have picked Weston as their family, you know, their place of where they reside. Why, Mom, what are we to do? Like this? She starts signaling people like a quarterback. So a few days back, the city of Weston publicly recognized on the record both organizations with a resolution that I have in hand. Many people were not there, as many people do not attend city commission meetings. I think there are quite a lot of other more fun things to do. But these two organizations were there, strongly represented. It was a great night. It was actually one of the happiest meetings we've had in a long time.
Yes.
Plenty of pictures, a lot of laughter, and a lot of celebrating. And you were all there. And the mayor, on behalf of all of us, presented the organizations with this proclamation that I want to read to you. And I'm actually going to read it. It's not long, because every word is very powerful in it. Generally speaking, a proclamation is made very generic. And when we present it, we just go like the first paragraph and the last one. This one was not. This is a proclamation that was really tailored for these two groups, and I want to read it to you. Whereas International Women's Day, established by the United Nations in 1975 and officially recognized on March 8th of each year, is a major day of global celebration for the economic, political, and social achievements of women, connecting women around the world and inspiring them to achieve their full potential. And whereas International Women's Day recognizes and honors women who contribute to the welfare of their communities and celebrate the collective power of women, past, present, and future. And whereas the Weston branch of the American Association of University Women and Mujeres Latinas Impulsando Mujeres Latinas are celebrating International Women's Day this March 9th of 2013, right here at Broward Health in Weston. And whereas the celebration includes recognition of the contributions of local women who are helping others within our community with the presentation of the Community Service Star Award and Service of Distinction Award. Now, therefore, I, Vice Mayor Angel Gomez, on behalf of Mayor Daniel Sturmer, and Commissioners Toby Foyer, Jim Norton, and Thomas Coleman, do hereby proclaim March 9, 2013, as International Women's Day in the city of Weston, and congratulate organizations involved in bringing this important event to Weston, and for showcasing the contributions of local, national, and international women to benefit of their communities. I want to, if I can, just as a formality, if I can have Kamala and Valentina come up so I can give you once again in front of your colleagues this proclamation that is so important to us in the city of Weston. Please give them a big round of applause and thank you so much. You guys
this way, guys. Come on, look at that, nice smiles. Here we go.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you for having me.
Thank you. Thank you.
Is that okay?
I taught him right.
Thank you, Commissioner Gomez. Commissioner Gomez, thank you very much.
Thank you.
For all your support.
Absolutely, always.
That you have given to women and the fight we are having for women's rights, and I appreciate your support. Sharon, are you here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Good afternoon. I'm Sharon Argove, and I'm one of the board members of the AAUW Weston. And although I do not live in Weston, I do work in Weston. And I've been working here for about 11 years so far, and it's been wonderful, and I love being here. I'm the library director right across the street at American Intercontinental University, so you have a university right here in the city of Weston. I am here to present an award to someone, and that's for the Community Service Star Award. I'm going to present her, and then she's going to talk a little bit about what she's been doing. So at this time, I would like to present Andrea Nugent.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm a little bit hoarse, so bear with me. I'm so honored to be here. Dr. Kamala, thank you so much for recognizing me. And I had chemo on Thursday, but I promised I would not miss this event for the world. So I put myself together, put on my smile, and I came. I was diagnosed in 2002 with epilepsy, and in 2009 with stage 3 breast cancer. I'm no stranger to life's challenges and obstacles, and that's become my mission, and that's become my motto, to live beyond obstacles. I have been able to be fortunately blessed, despite what most doctors told me. They told me I would never work again, I would never drive again, I wouldn't have kids, and I'm so proud to say that going to school full-time, working full-time, I not only got my bachelor's, I got my MBA.
Wow.
And, and my proudest achievement is having my beautiful son, who is 6 years old, in the back of the room. All despite what doctors told me. In November of 2012, I was re-diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer, metastatic breast cancer that spread to the liver. So I'm currently undergoing what they say this time around is chemo for life. But I serve an awesome God, and let me tell you, He's never let me down before. They told me, every time I go into the center, they say, I can't even imagine, you still have hair? And I said, yeah, God is good. Newer, improved change, because that's exactly how I felt. catching the bus home. I couldn't even imagine catching a bus after sitting 7 hours in a chemo chair. And I just decided I was going to start giving people rides. Simple as that. And my mom, who is also back there, Pamela, raise your hand. Idea or scheme I come up with, she's always there to roll up her sleeve and say, let's get it done, you know, and so I'm just honored. I'm doing what I saw her do all my life, which is give back to the community, give back to people, and I am so honored. I have an awesome group of volunteers who help me, and basically, you know, there's so many women who now come and say, thank you for being there. They don't have the support system that I had, and I just feel honored that I'm in a position to give back, even with being sick myself. And I just want to say thank you so much for having me. Thank you for recognizing. And there are so many women like me, and I'm honored to be in the same room with all of you who were nominated today. And thank you so much.
abject apologies for forgetting anyone. There were so many. I could have gone on for about 150 more, and then I forgot our congresswoman, and I should go like put my head in the sand somewhere. But she was in that big picture of the 113th. Yeah. Yeah, she was there.
So I don't want anybody to forget it. Right. We still have to get up there. And now I think Yvonne.
The vice. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Yvonne Salas, and I'm here today as Vice President of Mujeres Latinas, Impulsando Mujeres Latinas. It is a great honor and pleasure to be here with you this afternoon, sharing all of this. I think it's a good time to be a woman, wouldn't you agree?
I would.
But there's still, as Kamala said, so much to be done. I am here now to introduce to you the Community Service Star Award. It is with great pleasure that I introduce to you a Weston resident, Mrs. Lisa Lerner. She founded in 2007 an organization called Kids Helping Kids. She will give you some details now in a few minutes, but I just wanted to share with you the power of one person starting something small, something within your home, and how that has the ability to change people's lives. So without further ado, Mrs. Lisa Lerner.
And each and every one has truly gotten something positive out of it.
The kids at Royal Palm Elementary are so excited when they walk into school on the first day and see this backpack filled with great supplies waiting for them. It makes them feel so good, and the kids know that someone really cares, and we hope this will make them have a great school year. Kids Helping Kids' mission is to find activity where kids of all age groups can help out in the community. One great project we have helped out with for many years is the Harvest Drive. This is a community-wide collection of canned goods to go to underprivileged families. This takes place for Thanksgiving. I try to get a group of kids together, and we head up to the gym at Western High School and help to sort out all the canned goods. It is a great opportunity to see how the community comes together. The whole gym is filled with canned goods that have been collected from all the Broward schools. The kids have a blast helping to sort out, and it's such a great way to come together to help out. Another project that Kids Helping Kids has done is gather a group of kids and visit sick children at the Chris Everett Children's Hospital. Every child brought wonderful gifts, snacks, and books to read to the sick children. We went with a group of about 20 kids and parents and really made a difference at the hospital. Yes, I feel that this has been made a big difference in my child's life, but in so many other children as well. I hope that every child has walked away with a great feeling of giving and helping in the community. I hope this sticks with them through their adult years as well. Maybe if we all gave a little, our world would be a better place, but it is so important that you try. I would not have been able to do any of this without the wonderful support of my family. My husband, Kevin, who's here, is so supportive. My kids, Aaron and Rachel, Aaron's who's 13 and Rachel who's 11, are my true inspiration. They are really my very best friends, and I love being with them. I feel so blessed to have this most incredible family who are my cheerleaders in life. Today, my dad, my sister, my brother-in-law, my nephew, and my friends are here today to support me as well, and I am so thankful for them. Thank you to the Weston community for all your support and helping out. Thank you for the wonderful honor. It means so much to me. Congratulations to the other award recipients. I'm proud of all of you. And now I'll end with one of my favorite quotes. Not one can do everything, but everyone can do something. Thank you so much.
Introduce International Solidarity for Human Rights. International Solidarity for Human Rights is a 501c3 organization founded in the state of Florida in 2008. It was founded by Elizabeth Sanchez Vega and Deborah Sacha with the mission of educate and create awareness about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. They have done a wonderful work with Miami-Dade College and the community of Miami, and their goal is to make the Universal Declaration known everywhere. Here, Elizabeth Sanchez Vega is with us, and Deborah Sasha and Ana Maria, the directors, okay? And
thank you. Good afternoon.
I have to turn off the lights.
Turn off the lights and prepare for the presentation. One moment. Okay, my name is Deborah Sasha. I am a director of International Solidarity for Human Rights. As 501c3, we have dedicated all our potential or our knowledge since 4.5 years ago to the task of educating and learning about human rights. Why human rights? And I ask you, I want to start this presentation asking you, do you know about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights? Do you know that it was, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was signed in 1948, 65 years ago. And Kamala was talking about women's rights, the right to equal pay for equal work. This is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And Article 23 says, I quote, Article 23, everyone has the right to work, to free choice of employment, to just a favorable condition of work, and to the protection against unemployment. Everyone, without any discrimination, has the right to equal pay for equal work. So, this is written here 65 years ago, and still we are fighting, you know, for our rights. Not only for women's rights, for gay rights, for men's rights, for children's rights, but at the end we are fighting for our human rights that are belong to us since we are born. They are inalienable, and we have to embrace them, and we have to exercise them in order, you know, to make them live each day among us. So with this, I want to say that in 1948, it was the first time in history that a document considered to have universal value was adopted by an international organization. That international organization was the United Nations. In the aftermath of World War II, with memories of the Holocaust still fresh in the world's collective mind, the United Nations set about the task of creating a document that would guide a new and a better world, a world where humanity wasn't so horrifyingly inhumane, a document to protect the people from the horror of discrimination, torture, killing, crimes that the Jewish population had suffered during that time. Thus, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was drafted, and a woman, Eleanor Roosevelt, was the driving force behind it. She used to say, and I quote, and you will agree with this quote, I bet, a woman is like a tea bag. You never know how strong she is until she gets in hot water. And for sure, we every day get in hot waters, and we, you know, strive to, I mean, to our passions and to make what we want happen and become a reality. So that is what we did. Ana Maria Leonardi, director, she's from Venezuela. Elizabeth Sanchez Vegas, president, she's from Venezuela. And Deborah Sasha, director, we are all from Venezuela. And you know what is happening in Venezuela right now. So we have a lot of reasons for, you know, when we started the foundation, the organization, that was our reason. But it has become more than that, because we are trying to teach the whole world to embrace this Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And do you know that only the declaration has 30 articles? There are only 30 articles, and they are us. And you can read it in 15 minutes. And do you know that this declaration has been translated in 360 languages and dialects? And yet, only 5% of the world population knows
that it exists, and only 1% has read it. So I wonder why nobody, you know, respects the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, because if you don't know it, you cannot exercise your rights. So our mission in International Solidarity for Human Rights is to create awareness and educate in a positive way, in a positive way. We decided to do a different approach, because all you see about human rights are the images of the violations, you know, and we know violations are occurring in every hour, every day, every country around the world. So we decided to do this task through art. And why art? Because art is a universal language, can be understood by everybody. So we decided to take all the expression of art and make it represent the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And what you see, some of the works that we've done with Miami-Dade College and the students about human rights, represent each right with an image, with a thought, with a poem. And we started doing our task in 2009, trying to break a Guinness World Record. A Guinness World Record, the longest reading marathon out loud by a teen, reading only the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. But as I said, it's read in 15 minutes, so we read for 240 hours, 10 days, nonstop, at Inter-American Campus, Miami-Dade College, and we did break the Guinness World Record, 240 hours. The document that has the Guinness World Record, because it's the most translated, the most sold book in the world, which is the Guinness World of Records book. So, and the next year we decided, you know, to, and by the way, we were 6 women, okay, doing the record. Next year we traveled to Spain. Have you heard about the Way of St. James? El Camino de Santiago?
Yes.
It's a spiritual path, and we went to Spain to travel, to walk on foot for 240 miles. So we walked 10 days on foot. We had our pocket guides to human rights that we gave to every people we encounter along our path. We gave the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and until we get to Santiago de Compostela. And we were blessed and everything, and it was a wonderful spiritual experience. And we were, as you see the picture, we were 15 women and only one man, Jimmy. Poor Jimmy! I mean, had to put up with all of us, our needs and our, you know, feelings, because it is a quiet trip, I mean, quite a journey on foot. So after we did this traveling to Spain, we decided, we were inspired by the Camino de Santiago, the Way of St. James, and we decided to do the Route to Human Rights. The Route to Human Rights, inspired in the Camino de Santiago, we decided that we were going to do a route where we will represent 30 articles, the 30 articles of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, with 30 pieces of art, and invite 30 artists to represent each one of the articles in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And after the route is finished, probably, and we hope so, in 2015, we will issue a passport where you can, you know, during your visit to the 30 pieces of art, you will be collecting stamps and everything and learning about human rights. So the first, we, okay, put our heads and started to construct, to build the route to human rights. And in 2010, we did our first installation in Inter-American campus of Miami-Dade College. As you can see, it's a plaza where we put installed a 16-foot sculpture of that represents Article 19. We have freedom of expression, and was donated by artist Mauro Arbiza from Uruguay, and we brought the piece, you know, from Uruguay, and we installed it in a beautiful, beautiful event. And there you can see that plaza in the corner of the 27 with 8th Street downtown. And it's a beautiful piece, and Inter-American campus, we also, once we installed the piece, we created a human rights committee. And with the students, we do activities all related to human rights. The second plaza, in 2011, we had the collaboration of a Spanish artist, Dimo, who donated these beautiful children, 10 sculptures of children of different colors, representing Article 2, freedom from discrimination. So we installed the plaza. We had the collaboration of constructors, architects, and a lot of people that contributed to the building of this second plaza too. And we unveiled the second plaza at Miami-Dade College North Campus. The third piece of art represents Article 1. We are all born free and equal in dignity and rights. And was a huge painting, almost a mural, from Jorge Daher, a painter from Venezuela, represented the freedom through a little horse, you know, just of a newborn horse running in freedom. And we are planning to construct 8 plazas, but we have 30 articles, so where do we put the 22 that we are missing? So we decided to build a human rights pavilion. And it's going to be built, si Dios quiere, as we said, if God wants us to do it, and we are going to do it in 2013, this year. The pavilion is inspired in Article 29. We have duties to the community. So the architect was inspired by this article and designed the pavilion accordingly. It represents Article 29. So we are in the process. We have the land. It's going to be constructed in the Miami-Dade College North Campus. We have the renderings. We have the design. We have the place. So we need the money. That's all you know. So well, this year our goal is to raise the money to construct, you know, the physical installation of the pavilion. So we're going to find. So you know, we've been featuring in the Miami Herald. Thank you. Really, and Miami-Dade College has been a wonderful partner. I mean, because our goal is to educate. And in Miami-Dade College, we have 174,000 students that are going to be our ambassadors, and that are talking about human rights every day right now. Because we have not only, you know, build the plazas and install the art pieces, we have done a lot of programs, events, speakers that come and speak about the actual issues of human rights. For example, this, I have the right to marry. I have the right to marry. And we have, as a speaker, a woman that was a man, transgender, that had, when he was a man, two sons,
but she decided to change her sex. And she did. And now she's a beautiful woman. And she has a partner right now. And is doing her life. But she can now get married. So we, through those issues, we approach the human rights. Bullying. What is bullying in the schools? Mm-hmm. Discrimination. Mm-hmm. Discrimination, only that, Article 2. So that's what we're doing. And we created this little book that is the Illustrated Pocket Guide to Human Rights. It's a short version of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, illustrated so you can, you know, read it easily. And in the back has the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in English and Spanish. It's a complete version. And we have the books over there, so before you go, please, I want you to take one home and keep it with you forever, really, and read it, and read it and understand it. And as our, you know, our figure that we love the most is this lady, also Eleanor Roosevelt, that said, where, after all, do universal human rights begin? In a small place, close to home. So close and so small that they cannot be seen on any map of the world. Yet, they are the world of the individual person. The neighbor he lives in, the school or college he attends, the factory, farm, or office where he works. Such are the places where every man and every woman and child seeks equal justice, equal opportunity, equal dignity without discrimination. Unless these rights have meaning there, they have little meaning anywhere. Without concerted citizen action to uphold them close to home, we shall look in vain for progress in the larger world. Thank you very much.
We are very proud to give you the Service of Distinction Award.
With Miami-Dade. I worked there for 23 years.
Oh my.
Yeah, for all the campuses.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I was housed in the Kendall campus. My office was in Kendall campus. But I served all the 5 campuses, so I have a connection. And I'm glad they are doing, they're very good at that. Now it is my privilege to introduce, last but not least, recipient of the Community Service Star Award. When I read about her in the paper, I said, wow, if somebody can do this at 14 years of age, what have I done for all the years I've lived on this earth? You know, it was just amazing. I got goosebumps all over me. And I don't know how to contact her because I only knew she lived in Devi. Just a name is not going to help me. But then I looked at the paper article again and I saw who wrote it. So I contacted the person who wrote it and I said, we want to do an award for this young woman. Could you have them get in touch with me? And they did. And here she is, Eve Moore, a 14-year-old artist who had discovered her talent for giving. She's a student at St. Thomas Aquinas in Fort Lauderdale. Began donating her art to different causes more than 3 years ago when a friend of hers had a brush with cancer. And she has so far raised more than $30,000 for charities. Organizing and even to raise funds, and if we raise $1,000, we are so happy. And here she is, in 3 years, has raised $30,000 for different charities. Her list of beneficiaries has grown and includes Food for the Poor, the Broward County Medical Association, and Facing a Risk of Cancer, Empowered. She spends 2 days a week taking art classes and filtering requests from various local groups that seek her help. Everything from canvases to sell at fundraisers, images for posters, or paintings to print on cards. Her latest project is for kids in distress, which works with victims of domestic violence. The painting is of a young girl clutching a large starfish. She looks a little scared, but still looks pretty, intense, and powerful, Eve said. She symbolizes children that are being abused, and how even though they may be scared, they are getting saved. It's amazing to watch her world, said her mother, Diana Moy. She has an ability to translate her gifts into something else, something bigger than she is. Eve says she's not sure what she wants to be when she grows up, but she adds, I found a way to help people through my art. It's something I never want to give up. She has donated one of her works to us that is sitting on the table. Thank you, Yi, for your gift and for using your talent for philanthropy at such a young age. More power to you, girl, more power to you.
Society and the Achievement of Rehabilitation Center. When I talk about art by Eve, I find it necessary to mention Lucy Science, my art teacher, who is a very talented Venezuelan artist. And also my parents, Diana Wall and Frank Wall, who are very supportive. I hope to continue art by Eve throughout high school and afterwards. Thanks again for your support.
For coming, very impressive with all the works that have been going on, and you have enriched our lives. And in the program, you know, everything starts very small and then grows big. And at the back of your program, there is a story about how AAUW got started with two women, and today we are 100,000 and more. And courtesy of Mujeres Latinas, there are refreshments waiting for you in the back. Enjoy it.